Greetings, everyone. Today, I am standing in the Yukon Territory of Canada in front of the fairly large Yukon River. While many people correctly think of Yukon as containing bears, towering mountains, numerous glaciers, and important natural resources such as gold, which, among other elements and mineral commodities, represent more than 95% of this territory's exports, the region also has something else: volcanoes. And these volcanoes, especially south and southwest of Whitehorse, have been producing intermittent eruptions for millions of years, going back to around 8.5 million years ago. One of these lava flows produced from a little-known system of two volcanic cones almost certainly erupted at some point since the end of the last ice age 11,650 years ago, forming the latest lava flow at the Alligator Lake volcanic complex, which is a mere 38 kilometers southwest of where I am standing. While the Alligator Lake complex is interesting, it merely represents the latest in a series of basalts which, when clustered together, are referred to as the Miles Canyon Basalts. The most famous of these lava flows can be seen right behind me, where we have a clear view of several basaltic columns alongside black volcanic rock, which forms several layers. These unusual rock formations stretch for approximately a 6.5-kilometer-long length of the Yukon River on both sides, and heavily stand out against the eroded Cretaceous-era igneous intrusive rocks that dominate the surroundings with lighter-colored rock types such as granite and quartz monzonite. These basalt lava flows have been used as a landmark for hundreds, perhaps even thousands of years. So, why exactly do they exist, and when and where do they originate? Part of the answer to this question can be found offshore of Yukon to the southwest in the Pacific Ocean. There, the 550-kilometer-long Queen Charlotte Fault exists, which is a lengthy transform fault with largely horizontal rather than vertical motion, much like the San Andreas Fault in California. For at least 20 million years, this fault has been the boundary of two tectonic plates where the Pacific Plate is sliding to the north and the North American Plate is sliding to the south. This motion has caused a section of the crust spanning several hundred miles in length to begin rifting apart at a rate of approximately 2 centimeters or 0.8 inches a year, spreading to the east and west. The mantle is fairly shallow in that region, so as the area spreads, upwelling hot material sometimes intrudes into the crust, occasionally erupting onto the surface and forming a chain of volcanoes known as the Northern Kerguelen Volcanic Province, which encompasses these volcanoes. The first and most prominent Miles Canyon basalt lava flow erupted 8.4 million years ago, involving what I estimated to be around 1.1 cubic kilometers of lava. This occurred at a single vent located 8 kilometers south-southwest of the modern Yukon River, which today still rises over the surrounding forest and contains a steep rocky slope covered with dark-colored extrusive volcanic rock. But try and imagine a time where this cinder cone did not yet exist and instead there was a dense forest. Then, after a series of earthquakes, cracks opened up in the ground. An orange glow then became visible until finally, bombs of lava were being thrown high into the air, lava fountains were ongoing, and moderate amounts of ash were being emitted as part of a Strombolian eruption. Lava then poured out of this vent on its northeastern side, being directed towards the northeast by regional topography. As forests were burned by advancing molten rock, Pohoihoi and A'a lava reached a river, temporarily damming and then crossing it. The eruption, which likely lasted for several months, continued to output molten rock for some time, being funneled into a valley to the north. Due to the thick mass of recently erupted lava, it took a very long time for parts of it to cool. The lava on top cooled first. It consisted of numerous evenly spaced centers. As it cooled, the lava contracted towards these centers in an even manner. Due to this representing the easiest breakage pattern due to contracting, this primarily occurred from six different sides. Over time, these primarily hexagon fractures propagated downwards to the rest of the overall lava flow. After this process occurred, what remained was a grouping of primarily six-sided basaltic columns, which, along with the adjacent lava flow, was later cut into by the Yukon River, forming a small canyon which today is known as the Miles Canyon. As a final note, I would like to thank YouTube user PlayNowWorkLater, who helped show me around the Miles Canyon basalts and Whitehorse, while also providing me with some footage to use. Be sure to check out his channel, which is linked in this video's description. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below.